Hi again. Now that we've integrated our new API into Howler and we've kind of gotten to the far end of how that's all going to work, and we have a better understanding of how it's going to operate for us and benefit us in the future, I'd like to go ahead and talk about our design goals and what we had in mind when we started this thing. So let's just dive into a programming language. I'm going to use VB6 because it is COM-based. It's just natural for working with Howler, which is a COM server, an ActiveX server. You could equally use just VBNet or anything else that supports COM, but I'm going to use this for today since I'm comfortable with it. Just going to throw in a button at this point so we have a command we can execute of some sort. The first thing we want to do is make a reference to Dogwaffle. And we want to make sure we have the right one. There might be several on your machine. I don't know. But I'm going to get the one that's in program files, x86, and hit OK. And as soon as we've done that, we're going to automatically have access to some global features in Dogwaffle Howler. By typing in the immediate window, you can see that we have a little dropdown that shows quite a number of features that we have just automatically available. Now, this is our existing... our pre-existing classes that we've always had in Howler. The API we've added on top of this has objects that need to be created. That's because they are objects that you might want to have multiple instances of. They have to manage their own data and that sort of thing internally. So you really want to make an instance of it and not just have it globally available. But even now, there's some things we can do, such as seeing what the... let's see, get buffer, let's see, buffer size, buffer height, let's see what the buffer height is. Alright, we want to print that, of course. I don't want to just execute it. And since I don't have a copy of Howler running, it's probably going to start up a copy, start up an instance. Yeah, there it goes. So... once Howler is actually running, we'll be able to... yeah, you see it just printed 480. That's the initial size of the buffer that's when the program starts up. Once it gets running, it'll have a different size. So let's just pop this in the background. And try that again. And... okay, now you say it's 768. That's the current size. So just with that initial Dogwaffle object, there's quite a lot you can do globally. Those features have been in there for quite a while, so I don't need to explain those again. That's all available in our SDK. A lot of preset colors, a lot of preset functions, access to animation brushes, the internal buffers, etc., etc. But say we want to do something with the new API. Let's go ahead and do that. Let's look in the object browser. F2 on the keyboard will bring us into the object browser. And we'll select, Dogwaffle as our library or our object that we want to examine. And you can see there's a ton of new classes inside of here. Just an absolute ton of new classes in here. AVI class, dog events, fractal paper, all kinds of stuff, keyframing, color, matrix, drawing. Let's do something with the drawing class. This is a vector drawing class that lets us create objects using... it's sort of a wrapper for GDI Plus, but it extends it into three dimensions or that sort of thing. It supports L systems and a number of things. So let's create... go into our command button. The code behind on our command button. Go in there on the click event and... type, dim d as new, I think it's called VB drawing, and d dot begin draw. Now, everything with this object you want to close, enclose within a begin and end. So I'll close it with end draw. There's a begin 3D and a begin curve and that sort of thing. In fact, let's do that. I'll also set the anti-aliasing to true. I'll Set of pen color, fill color to, let's see, that's another thing. We also have a new color class. So I'll go ahead and create a color object while I'm here. Dim C as new VB color. Let's color. And it'll say C dot set color. C dot set RGBA because we want the alpha. 255, 100, 40, 30, whatever, and the alpha. All right. I'll set the fill color to that C color. Then I'll let's do something simple first. D dot draw. Let's draw a ellipse. All right. D dot ellipse. 100, 50. And let's go ahead and run that. So press that command button, and voila, in Haller we see an ellipse drawn for us. We can do some other things with that. Let's go back here. Let's give it a D dot use fill, and let's say use fill. It's equals, that's it, equals true. All right, so I'm gonna run that and let's see, I should have done something. I might have to be outside. Let me try that. Shouldn't. Oops. Okay, not sure why that's not working, but maybe it's a bug. Let's try some other things. Oh, I know why. Oh, that actually could be a bug. Anyway, I'll make a note of that in a minute here. Like I say, we're on the far end of this, but we are still not quite to the beta stage yet. We're still in the alpha stage. All right, so this is basically showing our new API. We already used the color class and the drawing class. Let me show you a few more things we can do with this color class, because there's a lot to that. You can set the red, green, and blue and alpha independently. You can convert it to hue, saturation, and value. You can lerp between, linear interpolate between two different colors. You can convert to luminance or saturation, change the saturation. Let's see, you can use a pack color. It's like a web color, sort of. And there is, web colors from name is kind of cool. And a YUV as well. So those are just a few of the things you can do with the color object. It's a lot more advanced than just setting a color. So that's very cool. And let's do another thing here. I did say there was a begin draw, end draw. You could also make this begin 3D and end 3D and add a third parameter, a Z parameter to this ellipse or to lines or whatever. But let's do another thing. Let's do a shape. And we'll do it the same way we did begin shape. We'll do D dot begin shape, D dot end shape, And inside of that, we'll use a vertex. D dot vertex. And we'll give it some parameters like 100 comma. And we'll do another vertex, D dot vertex. Let's see, 80 comma 100. Dot vertex 80 comma 80 All right, so this should make a new shape for us. Let's see what happens. Oops, let's see. Did I make a mistake somewhere? What did that say? Member not found. I see you type it up. All right. All right, oh, there's our fill. Weird. Oh, I think we need to do a screen refresh, actually, after we've done this. That might be the problem. Why I didn't see that fill earlier. I think I'll erase that. So, yeah, so, there we just drew a, let me just clear this. There we just drew this custom shape just using these commands. Very simple. We didn't have to allocate any memory. We didn't have to deal with pens or brushes or any of that stuff you'd use with GDI+. We just used simple commands like stroke, no stroke, that kind of stuff. Or setting the stroke and fill color. In fact, let me Yeah, we can turn that stroke off, or we can make it bigger. All right, so that might actually have to be inside the begin draw and draw thing here. Let me check that. Some of these have to be inside the begin and draw. So yeah, that was it. Most of this stuff is designed to be inside the begin and draw pair. There are a few things you can do outside, but there's not really any reason to have to do that. You could actually probably move these in here. Let me try that. Anyways, yeah. Okay, so. Actually, that should be above the set pen color. So, anyways. That is an introduction to our new API. Just a few of the things it can do. It's a lot more to it, but I'd have to like dig into it because there's just so much to it. Like I said, this supports. In fact, let's do a few more things. Let's try D dot rotate. Let's see, X, Y, we want to rotate around Z, which would, let's do it. Let's see. Not sure what's going on there. This is in fact my first time using this from an external through COM from an external program. I've only used it up to now. I've only used it in the Okay, so I do know this works because I use it all the time, but some reason it's not working for me to write at the moment. We should technically be seeing this anti-alias as well. I'll probably get these things sorted out and do another tutorial, but anyways, it's a start. Let's see, get pixels. That'll be something. There's a lot to this. Polar Cartesian. Push and pop matrix. That's an interesting set of things. A lot of use of matrices and that sort of thing. Gradients. And etc. So that will be the tutorial for later once I get my my mind refreshed on how all this stuff works. But while we're here, let's try maybe a few more things. Let's see what would be a good thing to do. The stack, that's an interesting one. That'll be a tutorial by itself. Vector math, that'll be a tutorial by itself. Whirly object, that will be interesting to play with. VB noise, let's try something with VB noise real quick if we can. Refresh myself on how this works. Noise, octaves, spot size. Okay, let's see what we can do with this. Let's try something. Let's see what happens here. And okay, so it's being a little frustrating. I'm gonna come back and do a tutorial on this in a few minutes here, and we can talk again later. Thanks for watching, and ta-ta for now. All right, a slight addendum to the last video. I had neglected one thing. It was not a bug. I remember that matrices are cumulative, so if you want to make a a loop that translates or rotates an object, you simply have to call a reset matrix each time. Otherwise, each time you call a matrix translate, it will add to the last one. And that's why I was not seeing those changes, because they just shot off screen, basically. So I just added a d.reset matrix to this. And now, as you see here, I'll run it again. And we are now plotting that 1D noise. Excuse me. Plotting that 1D noise, fractal noise, along the y-axis of this little circle that's being drawn here. So there you go. All right, so that is handling all the rotation and all that stuff for us. So let me see if I can go back to this. Not sure I have all this. No, I can't get back that far. I'll just do a quick. Something or other. So let's see. Let's do something different this time. Be good. Curve, maybe. Curves work the same way. In fact, I'll plant a bunch of random points at this point. Let's see. Let's see. Let's go to pi, in fact. 0 to pi step. 0.1, maybe. 0.01. All right. Or maybe it's 2 times pi is what we want. Let's see what happens. Alright, so what do we want to do? We want to do, like, polar to cardinal, maybe. See if we can do this. Here we go. I wonder if this is in pi or what this is. I wonder how this is going to work. So it's radius and angle, then it'll return x and y in the x and y. So, Let's see, how do we want to do this? So radius would be 100, and angle will be x. Then we'll have to make a new x and y too, and let's see what happens. All right, try this again. And end curve. No idea at this point. Let's run this and see what happens. Screen. All right. Okay, there's a mistake there for some reason. Oh, X is already in use. Where am I using X? Oh, get rid of that. Let's see what we just did, if anything. Okay, well, I was expecting something to work. Let's see. What did I... and curve, begin curve and curve, huh? Let's see, X. It's the angle. Let's see, I'm not sure if this is in radians. I think it's probably in radians. Oh, I haven't actually defined x2, and let me see. X, y, no, I'm sorry. Radius, comma, angle, comma, x2, comma, y2. Else fails. So I'm basically making a video about me bug testing some software here. Alright, so anyways, fun experiment. Probably should have prepared for it. Come back later, and thanks for watching. By the way, this is the way programming is. All right, back again. Stupid mistake. Did not actually define what pi was, and so used to having pi already defined for me, I forgot I was starting in a new project with nothing defined. So I just went ahead and defined pi. I got my calculator out, scientific, get pi, got all this stuff down there, copied it over here, and there you go. So just doing from 0 to 2 times pi gave me a circle. Let's make this a little more interesting. Let's change radius from 100 to something a little more interesting. Let's define radius as something. Give it a count times R&D. Make count equals something. What's wrong now? Count. Count is probably a predefined variable. Let's see. It's called J, I guess. And let's see. Add J, RD, whatever. Okay, let's see what this does. Okay, that's getting more interesting at least. Make it a little bit bigger. Interesting. Add something to it. Okay, so you can see we have some interesting possibilities in this drawing object. What did I equals? I showed you the VB noise. That's kind of interesting. Then we can start for an asteroid game. Let's make this a vertex instead of a curve, or a shape instead of a curve, and see what happens. Sort of an asteroid shape. Let's see what I just do. All right, and let's give it less steps. Let's point 0.5 instead of 0.4 instead of whatever. Make it a little rougher. There you go, asteroids. Yes, I was not intending to do that, but for you, all you kids, asteroids was a video game many, 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 many decades ago. So, yeah, maybe we'll change our drawing color, make this more interesting. All right, so there we go. Vector. Let's make a background black. I have this the very basic start for an asteroid game. All right, not intentional. Cute, huh? All right, so that's our drawing class. That's the VB. We also did some stuff with the VB noise. We could probably do some other stuff. There's a whole lot more in here. There's a picture class that has you can load pictures and blit them to the screen and other things like that. We have a Metafile class, which loads, let's see, I believe it loads Windows Metafile files and lets them be transformed and that sort of thing. And you can get the size and some other properties from the format and apply a transformation to it. Let's see, we did the noises, 1, 2, and 3 dimensional noises that you can access. There's a property stack, an interesting one. It supports XML. You can say properties to this stack of objects. It can all be different types of data, from arrays to double precision, all this sort of stuff. Sort of like a property bag, or a in more modern terms, a serialized class. Supports XML and string and raw loading and saving, and it's a good way to save properties. We'll probably use that for saving settings in the future. Image pre-image class, we're not there yet, but it's going to be real useful. Sprite classes, the same thing. Stack is a dynamic array that acts like a stack where you can push and pop, but it also has insert, splice, remove, that kind of stuff. All right, there's a some vector drawing. String class, we have a lot of new string pattern matching and replace and search and that kind of stuff, tokenize. All right, there's a double long class. Vector math class has a lot of vector classes, a lot of vector math functions that we let you do things like 3D math, basically. Same with, we have a matrix in there that will let you do transformations. There's a Whirly class that lets you do Whirly noise. There's a XML loader that you let you do things that's not attached to the property bag or the property class. There's some access to animation, the frame count, and you can go to a specific frame. There's a gradient class which lets you set gradient stops. Would love to dive into that one at some point. I'm a little out of practice at the moment. And let's see, color presets. We have a bunch of preset colors that you can access directly. Let's see, keyframing class lets you create keyframes and interpolate things along a curve, time values along a curve, basically. Very useful. There's a you can access an HDC because typically in Haller we used to use you had to read an array from Haller. Manually do things by creating your own drawing functions, but now you can get a excuse me a device context directly from Haller. Use something like GDI or GDI Plus in your own program, and then send it back to Haller. Basically, that's what gives you that gives you access to it. There's a camera class that goes with the drawing object for doing 3D stuff. 3D currently is limited to wireframe, but we will have some, hopefully some shaded triangles and things like that in the future. That'll be a tutorial by itself as well. Color class I already talked about. Color matrix will let you do color matrix functions to, not sure why that's not showing up, but there is a color matrix. You should be seeing that. There are functions in there. That could be a bug. Let me type that as well. They hope they do the next version of Windows make this note thing a lot faster. All right, so oh, there's a geometry class. This will be another tutorial as well. This lets you do loading OBJ files, and to some degree that works with the drawing class as well, although it's really intended to be its own thing. There's a kernel class for doing convolution kernels. You can apply it to do things like a Gaussian blur, tent filter, a box blur, edge detection, erosion dilate, some other things. And it gives you some support functions like summing the values in the kernel, some presets like box, cross, ellipse, and a few others, Gaussian, that will build the kernel for you. You don't have to manually put the values inside the kernel. There's a function to actually get a copy of the kernel, and you can set rows individually, that kind of thing. All right, so, L systems, we can talk about this some other day too. You can do turtle graphics with this basically works through the drawing class, but it supports turtle drawing and also specifically L systems by giving them rules. We can talk about that later. The matrix class has basically all your matrix math. There's a 2D version of that, which at this point is a wrapper for GDI Plus's 2D class. That's about it. I think we've covered everything. So that is our new API. It's available internally as well as to externally as for plugin developers. And so just looking at. All right. Hey again. Just one more quick addendum to the last video. Did indeed find a bug in the drawing. Shapes such as draw shape and draw curve, in that it did not support the matrix, and that has been fixed. We got a new build, recreated the demonstration video of the project in VB6. You can see our little asteroid thing rotating according to a matrix, just using this d.rotate command. And incrementing this by a small amount. We reset the matrix each time. Otherwise, that would have been a cumulative change. That could be useful also, but it's better to just go ahead and reset it when we want to do multiple things, like translating and then rotating and all that stuff. So, let's see. The couple other changes that we made. The Dogwaffle object now has more commands available globally, such as the 3D. You can already see some of the 3D things like calculate cross product and let's see, clear Z buffer. The 3D class has been made global as well, so they're available just from the Dogwaffle object here. Let's see. And that's basically it for now, I guess. So, just letting you know where we stand on the API stuff. Of course, this is just a small part of what we're doing in this future update, which will probably be 11 sometime, maybe middle of next year, or this year, 2000, whatever year this, whatever year you're seeing this video, 2017. Probably middle of 2017 or thereabouts, maybe a little sooner, hopefully. A lot of changes coming, but this is the under the hood stuff that we're showing right now. Not ready to show new features, but those are going to be based on this new API in a lot of ways. We will have some good features coming, but we'll talk to you about those later. Thanks for watching, and ta-ta for now.